start the planning commission meeting of June 28th, and let's start with the roll call.
Thank you. Chair Lane.
Here.
Commissioner Tonelli will be late. Commissioner Sokolow.
Here.
Commissioner Lamb.
Here.
Commissioner Lerner.
Here.
Okay, great. Now, the next item is a public comment section for items not on the agenda. And what we use this for if somebody's here to talk about something they might want to put on a future agenda or an item we didn't know about or something that they just have in their mind. So I'll open up the public comment section for items that are not on the agenda tonight. Anybody here to talk on those?
I just came by to introduce myself. Steve McCulley. I'm the new chief of police for the town.
Come on. Yes, I'm very familiar.
I'm not afraid to come up, so I've met some of you.
Yeah.
Just quickly, I'll tell you, I came from Washington State. Born and raised in Washington, worked in Seattle area most of my life, state police for about 30 years. Chief of police of two small cities where I've raised my family, and they're on their way, so my wife and I said, let's do something for ourselves. She found the job posting, and here I am. So I've been here 2 months. I've been extremely impressed with the team over at the police department. Everybody in town's been very gracious, met a lot of nice people, so looking forward to working with you all and being here for the long term.
Yeah. So we met Benita because I was...
You pulled it over?
Not yet.
He's got to go to jail. I would be pulling him over.
I'd rather Steve than people get angry at me. They go like, oh, they like her like that. I wouldn't run too. But we met during the interviewing process.
Yeah, so if it goes bad, he's partially...
Yeah, that's right.
I was about to say, you still came even though you met him, huh?
I've hired a lot of good people in my career. You'll be another one. All right, thank you. Thank you for coming out, too. I didn't have to do that. All right, so with that, we have the minutes from the May 24th meeting, and we were all there for that one, so just wanted to make sure that there's anything there that needs to be looked at or analyzed or talked about or changed. Yeah, and then we can go for a motion on that.
I have nothing, so I'll make a motion unless anyone else does.
No, I have nothing.
Okay.
All right. All right, moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None. 4-0. And one not here. And let's go for new business is the school master plan. Well, let me start by framing up these next sections. The way we approach this is we'll start every item with an overview from staff. And then any questions for the commission to staff, and then we'll open up the public comment section. We'll start with the person who brought the item forward to the commission, and then anyone else who wants to talk, and then we'll close the public session and bring it back for the commission discussion and action as appropriate. So that'll be the case on all the items that we're going to follow up with. So with that, we'll go ahead with the school master plan for Sacred Heart Schools.
Thank you, Chair. So every year, the all private schools within town come to the commission and provide the commission an update of their adopted master plans. All private schools are required to have one. Sacred Heart initiated theirs back in 2001. This is what is being presented to you tonight. As just a brief summary of the items presented in the staff report, the master plan has shown consistency in all of the topics that the town does require a master plan to address, including traffic and circulation, parking, enrollment, facilities to be developed, specifically heritage trees as well, and their hours and uses of operation. I would want to highlight the biggest change in the 2017 master plan relative to what the 2001 plan had adopted initially and subsequent amendments in 2017 prior years. And that has to do with their, what's called their Saval building. Previously noted to be updated and enlarged. The school is now proposing to completely demolish that building
and
construct a new academic arts building. That would be larger than the building that was previously identified in prior years' plans. That will trigger the need for a conditional use permit and environmental review.
Right.
When that application is formally submitted, and actually I should back up, I do believe the initial phases of starting the preliminary environmental review analysis have began already, so more than likely you will be seeing that conditional use permit application and environmental document, whether that will be in the form of a mitigated negative declaration or EIR that's being flushed out now in the review process sometime this year. The second component of the presentation the schools that have them, and Sacred Heart does, is a transportation demand monitoring program. Back in 2013, I think the schools did a conditional use permit change from what had identified actual physical transportation and circulation improvements on the site to the implementation of these TDM plans, as we're calling them. Staff then requires a third-party traffic consulting firm to provide updates on the actual physical counts to make sure that the school's parking counts are in line with what the plans have identified. The town retained the services of Hexagon Transportation Consultants. We actually have somebody here tonight who has some questions on the methodologies or numbers that were derived. But in conclusion, the counts were determined to be found to actually be much less than what the identified maximum number was. I believe it was 6,000 vehicle trips is in the adopted plan, and the counts concluded a total of 4,000, a little under 5,000.
Okay.
So with all of that, as summarized in more detail in the staff report, staff does recommend that the commission accept the filing of the 2017 master plan update for the Sacred Heart Schools campuses.
All right, great. All right, we're just going through Sacred Heart right now.
Thank you.
Just kicked it off. Welcome for sure. All right. Okay, quick question. Yeah, any questions with staff? There's no historical significance of the building, because that was one of the things that was going on with that building at one point, is that it was historically significant.
There is a cultural resources section, a template in the CEQA checklist, so if indeed there is historical significance found, whether it be by building, history, etc., that would need to be discussed and evaluated appropriately in the environmental document.
Okay, great. All right, super. We'll have a chance to do that when it comes before us.
Absolutely.
Right? Okay. This is just put it on a radar screen that they're thinking about doing that. Mm-hmm. Right? Okay.
Yes.
All right, good. So we'll go ahead and open up the item from Sacred Heart, and we'll listen to comments from the applicant first. Who's here from Sacred Heart?
Thank you. Mike Dwyer for Sacred Heart Schools. Saw you folks a month ago. Some of this will sound familiar, as we did discuss a little bit of it when we talked about the conditional use permit for the portables. This year we completed one project that was to replace our football field with new turf and got rid of the crumb rubber and put in an organic substance that actually makes the field 15 degrees cooler, and it being organic does not have any toxic concerns or dangers that anyone's aware of at this time. So we're really happy with that. We also put in a padding underneath it, which has significantly cut down on injuries to the players, and that is it's something that has been remarked by the coaches. They have less fatigue walking on the turf, so we're looking at doing that to the rest of our fields, but that'll be over time. Nothing planned for this next year with the other fields. The last year we presented in our master plan update that we proposed to take down two buildings and replace them with two new buildings. One of them was the Segal building, the other one was the McGanney gym. When we explored the costs and the impact, we decided that it wasn't the right choice to go for two buildings. And so we looked at replacing only one building, and then we were going to put the gym, the McGanney gym, on hold because academics and arts hold a higher priority in our need matrix. So subsequent to that, though, we had a developer step forward to help us develop the gym and do a voluntary seismic upgrade, and then TI work within the gym for a remodel. And that's ongoing right now, and the need for the portables that we discussed last month. With this new plan to replace the Segal building only, we propose to have a basement and two floors. It'll be 76,000 square feet. The intent is to have the classrooms we need now and whatever changes there are in the future to the educational system. And what we found is the best way to approach this is through flexibility, and that's how we're building these spaces. And I know that some people have asked what's flexibility. what it is having some classrooms open into other classrooms, having doorways to lead to the other classrooms, having transparency, having glass fronts, and so that there's some activity both in the hallway and in the classroom. So we're also, because of our location and the climate here in Atherton, we use the outdoors as classroom space as well. So this project is also looking at how to enhance that ability. The proposed new plan, you folks all got a packet of this. I don't know if you saw it, but the building would pretty much have the same footprint as the Segal building, with the exception of this hammerhead here that goes towards the Megany gym. But with Megany being 21,000 square foot footprint, and then the new building having about 25,000 square feet, it was designed very efficiently as opposed to the way Segal is designed at present. The proposed, if we were to change our drop-off and pick-up to the main building on the proposal that says, it also does say proposed conditions, it should have said turnaround. We are proposing that we cut off traffic around the main building during school time so that it becomes a pedestrian mall, and to affect that we'd have to create this circle right before the main building from Valparaiso if you were to come up the main drive. We're pretty sure we're not going to be able to do that this year, but I wanted to reintroduce it because it was introduced originally in 2009, and we had thought we would be able to get to it, but there were too many things. There's fire code, there's other considerations. If we were to take away 30 or 50 parking spaces, how do you replace that on campus? So what we decided to do was rethink it, and if we can come up with a plan, which we're pretty sure we have, with control gates and timing, we will get the cars in, have them park, not move until school is out, so in effect it becomes a pedestrian mall during school hours. So that's one of the things we're working on in the future. Oakwood, the retirement home for the RSCJ nuns, they had a proposed project on the books last year to expand the front of their facility to accommodate some visiting rooms, and they also wanted to add a fabricated housing unit to house additional retiring nuns. Two things have stalled their project. One is their project manager died recently, and so that project is on hold. As far as the need for the modular unit to increase their residency, I'm on that board. And so what we asked them to do, we asked administration to do, was go back and justify it with their actuarials, because some of the figures show that the retiring nuns is actually declining, not increasing. So we're waiting for them to continue that study and see where that project is. I don't see it lifting off this year, but I wanted to make sure we represented it.
So I'll wait till you finish, but I have a question to come back about that, about the nature of that building, all right?
Sure.
Okay, let's keep going.
Okay. So in this new plan, we do not anticipate to lose any parking spaces. With the last plan, when we were going to do the two buildings, we had anticipated losing 15 spaces, and we were going to have to relocate or find another 15 spaces on campus. What we did at that time was identify a place for two spaces, and we executed that last summer. So then that brought the need down to 13. But with that project scrubbed, we don't need to replace any parking. So that's another plus. Our goal was to identify a solution that creates more synergistic space for the current student population and programmatic needs associated with expanded high school curriculum. And I think this new program that we have for this new building will do that for the school. So that facility will house academic, fine arts, language arts, creative arts, performing arts, in a flexible open plan that promotes cross-pollination of ideas, free exchange of knowledge, through collaborative interaction, as I discussed a little bit earlier. So are there any questions on that proposed area before I go into the TDM?
No, I'll just wait until you're done.
Okay. So we had our TDM as discussed by staff earlier. It's 18% under the cap. It shows a downward trend, although it's about 300 higher this year than last year. We're confident that that will continue to reduce, and the reason is of the programs that we continue to pursue. We're not comfortable with not pursuing some sort of improvement yearly.
And for those who are in the audience and, up here also, though, TDM is traffic demand management. Just to make sure everybody's on the same page, right?
Yes.
Okay. Cool.
Thank you. We introduced this year to pilot two programs. One is a student carpool service that we use for alternate bus service, but we also introduce to the parents so that they can use for their children for any type of runs, whether it's to go to and from school, to and from sports events, to and from a store. And this service will also babysit the child if the parents are running late. So it's great. The drivers are background checked. They're trained on how to care for people. Their target audience is under 18 and the elderly over 65, where they need rides to certain areas so they get specific training. The other program that we're very excited about is a carpool service that we've engaged in. It's an application called Scoop, and we worked with Scoop. We also engaged Menlo School and some other neighboring businesses to get a collaborative effort in having a pool of carpoolers to go to and from school. The service guarantees if they get you a ride to the school, they will get you home regardless of the time. So if they can't find a carpooler for you to get home, they will call Uber, they will call a taxi service, they will do something to get the person home. And so with that pilot program, we've been able to eliminate several hundred cars from coming on campus in that short amount of time. We have only 10 of our 315 faculty signed up at this moment. So we're going to do a drive after the pilot has been successful. We're going to do a drive to increase that participation with targets. First, the Mid-Peninsula, second, the East Bay, and then third, the South Bay and San Francisco simultaneously. We hope to increase that percentage of at least those that register to about 25% of the faculty and staff, and maybe even achieve 20% utilization, which will really help everyone out in the long run. And right now we supplement at 80%, and we are looking to incentivize folks by doing it 100%. It actually would work out to be about 125%, because we will also pay the drivers additional to be participants. So as I said, we're really committed to continuing this downward trend. We promote our bicycle to school program. We have on average about 100 bicyclists that go to and from school, and those folks get to receive a $60 certificate for a tune-up or whatever else they may need for their bicycle. So there are a lot of things that we're committing to do for this program that we want to ensure that we're going to be successful. First time ever, we've decided to also cut back on certain events and to black out a certain day of the week so that families have some time to relax and we can give our staff time to relax on those evenings. The only exceptions will be events that could not be held on any other day, or sports events that again can't be held on any other day, but it's going to be very rare, and that's going to be Tuesday after 4 o'clock. So that's how we're also approaching what we're doing with this program. That also leads into our health and wellness program, where we're trying to balance things out for the families. The next area would be enrollment. We anticipate that this year's enrollment will be down to about 1173 when we start school. That's not where we hope to be. We would like to be around 1186. Our cap is 1196. We always leave room for those that move into the area for us to be able to consider them as applicants and students. And so this right here is not our sweet spot. But the thing with enrollment is it's not an exact science, it's almost an art, because you have to guess how many people you're going to be able to bring in from the applicant pool, and it's only in certain grade levels that you do this. So that's one of the things that we're trying to play with here. Part of this was a little bit deliberate. We lowered the enrollment opportunity in certain areas to beef up other areas. Some of those targets met, but then the other ones missed that we didn't anticipate missing. But the news is that we're not going over, and we have never planned to do that. So right now we'll be under. And I think that about wraps up.
Okay. Any questions? A couple questions then. On the traffic flow during construction, so it would be pretty normal for that kind of disruption to create backup onto the traffic on the main streets there. So how are you going to be handling that traffic flow during that, during those peak periods with all the construction going on?
So I guess there's two answers in there. The first answer is that the general contractor will have to submit a traffic plan with the town, and you folks will have to accept it. It will route out their routes to and from, the times that they are to do it, and where their people park, and where their staging areas are.
Okay.
So that's that part of it. What we're going to do is have more of our employees park across the street at the Mormon Church parking lot, along with the construction workers' personal vehicles in that area. We have not completely developed that part of the plan yet, because our start time is a little fluctuating right now. We hope to have some more clarity in about 2 months. And then once we have that, we should have a comprehensive plan on that.
All right, you have a traffic guard, you can have a crosswalk person there?
We always do, yes.
Okay. All right, and then is there gonna be any improvement to the flow on the site when it's all done? Is that being looked at?
That will be secondary to this.
Okay. The nuns' quarters, it sounds like they're prefab, so there's all the range of prefab is airstream to something lower. So what are you looking at in terms of the way that'll look and how it'll fit the architecture of that area?
So we actually have one of those units already on site. It's called our gatehouse.
Okay.
We put it in roughly 6 years ago, I want to say.
I've seen that.
Yeah.
It looks
so
like a building.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it will conform with that.
All right, good. And what about the historic significance of the Segal building? Is that being looked at, or is there anything that, because at one point that was one of the discussions was we're going to keep that because it's significant.
You know, I'm unaware of its historical significance. I hadn't heard that there was any concern over it.
Okay.
I do know that the firm doing the EIR study right now has looked at all of our buildings and actually looked at that building last year, so nothing came up when that preliminary work was done in that review.
The inside of that entry area is very nice, and you don't find wood like that anymore. And on the increased staff, 25%, it doesn't say how many people that actually is. So that either moves it from 4 to 5 or 40 to 50. So how much of a number of people is that on the increased staff?
I'm sorry, what increase?
It says that the staff increased 25% in the last 4 years, but it doesn't say how many that is.
Oh, okay. So it's roughly, and really it's more 4 years ago. But that is roughly about 26, 25, 26.
Okay, so it's about 100 total. All right. So is that driving an increase in traffic then? Because I saw that 2016, 2017 was an increase of 7%. on the peak. Is that what's driving the increased traffic?
No, I think there are two things that go into it. Number one is we select dates and we propose them to the town because I want to choose a day that we're not having nothing happen,
right,
but we're not having like everybody in the Bay Area there. So what we're asked to do is find dates that are typical. So I selected, you know, I think four sets of 3 days and said, here you go, you guys choose which ones they are. And that's a hit or miss. If it's a different week than last year, we usually have the same events on the same days of the week in those weeks. So it could just be that difference, or it could have been some sort of other anomaly.
Yeah, it could be more rain that people want to drive their kids to school.
Yeah, anything like that.
Yeah. Okay, that's all I have for questions. Anyone else have questions? All right, thank you. And then we'll see, is there anyone else, did you have anything else that you want to go over?
I think we're good.
Okay, good. Is there anyone else here to speak on this topic? We're on Sacred Heart right now. If not, then I will go ahead and close the public session and public hearing and bring it back to the commission for action as appropriate. Discussion action as appropriate. All right? Anything there that we need to go over? Pretty straightforward then. This is always been, you guys have been very good about that. I really appreciate the traffic plan that's helped, and I always say that I wish the public schools had this traffic plan. So it's very good. All right, anything, any other? Okay, now we need a motion.
I'll make a motion.
All right, yeah.
Okay, I move that the planning commission accept for filing the 2017 annual master plan update and TDM monitoring report from Sacred Heart Schools.
Have a motion. Motion is moved and second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? None. So 5-0. All right. Fully staffed. All right. Next item. And for those of you who came late, just the process that we're using is that we're going to be opening up a topic, and then the staff will give us an overview, and then we'll open it up for the applicant, and then we'll hear from anyone else who's speaking on the item, and then we'll close it, bring it back to the commission for discussion and action as appropriate. So the next item is the public hearing 5A, special structures permit for 94 Sabala Lane. How do you say it? Sabala Lane? All right, Sabala Lane. I was there, but I didn't know how to say it. All right, very good. Go ahead, staff.
Thank you. So the trigger for the special structures permit request before you tonight at 94 Sabala Lane is that the property is located in our R1B zoning district, and the extent of the improvements that the property owner wants to do, specifically as a first floor addition, quite small, 82 square feet, does not conform to what the standard setback requirement would be. This 82 square foot first floor addition would continue an existing wall line that's already established at a slightly over 35 foot side yard setback, whereas today's requirements would trigger the need for that setback to be 38 feet. So instead of pulling in that addition, the addition and additional 3 feet, the applicant would like to just continue that wall line. And because of the fact that it's a legal non-conforming setback and that the property is in the R1B zoning district, per our municipal code, requires the issuance of a special structures permit by the town commission. So that is why we are here. There's some additional square footage that the applicant is also proposing to do as part of this development in the rear of the property. You can see it on the site plan, hatched in a little dark area, slightly over 100 square feet. That conforms to all of today's current setbacks. I spoke extensively with the property owner to the right side of this property, or closest to that small addition, and explained the process and the application to him. He was unclear when he received the notice, and at the end of our conversation, he was amenable to the development. So all other aspects of this small addition do comply with our height and floor area and all the development standards. So coupled with the facts that I presented previously, and as noted in the staff report, we are recommending that the commission approve the special structures permit to allow for the continuation of a legal and non-conforming setback at the property. I'm happy to answer any questions, and it looks like we have the property owner here as well.
All right. So I'll go ahead. Any questions of staff?
Yeah, so specifically, what were the initial concerns of that neighbor to the right side of the house?
He just was unclear as to what was going on and why the commission was looking at this application and if there were variances or special exceptions being granted. So I just needed to explain the extent of what the application was and the trigger under the regulations of the town's municipal code as to why.
Questions? Okay, then I'll go ahead and open up the floor for the applicant or anyone here on behalf of the applicant. Or if you're good, then, you know, that was the best presentation I've heard all night. All right, if anything comes up, I'll open it up for you, okay? All right, so go ahead and I'll close the public hearing then. There's nobody else, was there anyone else to speak on this subject? Then I'll go ahead and close the public hearing and bring it back to the commission for discussion and action as appropriate. Yeah, it's pretty. I didn't see anything that went out to the site, and it looked pretty straightforward. I drove there and took pictures, and it looked like it was straightforward. Any other comments?
No, just that one addition looks like it would fall right within the footprint of what would be there anyway.
Yeah, right. All right, so
I would make a motion.
All right, good. Go ahead.
The Planning Commission approved a special structure permit at 9 Cross Bottle Lane based on findings of the reasons enumerated in the staff report, subject to the conditions listed in the special structure permit certificate to allow for an addition to a legal non-conforming building to go beyond the main building area.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None. Hector, you should give people instructions on how to do this. Thank you. All right, very good. Next item is item 5B, Special Director's Permit on 168 Alena Avenue, and we'll start with the staff report.
Thank you. So tonight you're being asked to consider the request for a special structures permit that would allow a basement garage underneath an accessory building at 168 Alena Avenue. This is probably the first, it's not probably, this would be the first type of application that you would have seen in this nature since we staff, the town, revised the basement ordinance approximately 2 years ago. Part of those revisions included specific language that prohibited garages as basements under accessory buildings. Going back to the spirit and intent of that prohibition was to preclude some problematic issues we had seen with garages as basements under accessory buildings and the large excavation that's associated with a subterranean garage and the long driveway that's created that could effectively be equated somewhat to a large outdoor usable light well of sorts, and the potential noise and other impacts that could be associated with that subterranean driveway. This is a somewhat unique request in that the basement garage does not propose any associated subterranean driveway to actually access it. All access to this garage basement would be interior to the building. So the basement under the accessory building itself is proposed as a garage. If you took the basement component out of it, that accessory building complies with all standard zoning regulations of the town. It would be able to be approved at the staff level. The way that this proposal has been crafted is that that basement garage area, again, as I mentioned, would be accessed internally from the building with hydraulic lifts that would maneuver the vehicles up, over, down, in, and back, forth. So it, in effect, would not know that the garage basement actually was there. In terms of access to that basement area, beyond the internal hydraulic lift access that I just described, there would be one exterior staircase that would provide access to the basement within the allowable setbacks for an accessory building. Because it's non-habitable space as defined by the building code, there's not the additional requirement for that stairwell to be located in the interior or on the interior of the building side. So with the existing conditions of the site and with the arborist's professional opinion and her evaluation of the site and the plans, and that no heritage trees would be impacted with the excavation work that would be associated with the basement. Staff is recommending approval of the special structures permit.
Okay. Any other any questions?
I have a couple of questions. Is this stairwell entry the only access to this subterranean area?
Beyond the interior of the garage.
So
you could get
the
basement from the inside.
You have to go in and out through that doorway. There's no other.
No, there's not.
Are there any window wells? Is there?
No.
Has ventilation or fire safety been considered here?
I have the building department give a preliminary evaluation of the garage, and they did not alert me to any significant code issues that the basement would face. So if the commission were to approve the use of the basement as a garage, the applicant's next step, of course, would be to provide those detailed working drawings to the building department, at which time all light, egress, ventilation requirements for a basement, a non-habitable basement as this garage would be defined as, would need to be met.
Okay, because I would not be comfortable with it if I thought that was the only escape hatch. And those who are familiar with car shows and car people know that the first requirement of a car being shown or toured is to have a fire extinguisher on board because of the incidence of fires associated with cars, especially older collector cars. And if that fire broke out in the stairway side of the building and you were standing over on the other side of the building, you'd be in big trouble.
Right.
There's no ventilation, there's no fire. I mean, I'd want to be assured before I agree this was covered.
Well, part of that building permit plan check review process
sounds like it would cover it all right. I'm just going on record to say that's my
concern.
Sure,
is the inclusion of the Menlo Park Fire District's
good.
Review.
They'll doubtless have something
report
to say about it.
Yeah.
Question regarding additional noise and activity required to create a basement space being so close to the neighbor's property line. So are there any noise issues or concerns that might arise that we could anticipate? Because I imagine there's heavier equipment, more people on the site to dig so deep.
During the construction. There's the standard noise, construction noise limitations that would be associated with any type of construction throughout the town. If the basement was to be a storage area, for example, or if it was to be a usable space, a living area, those same noise limitations would apply regardless of the use of that basement.
And do we have any ratio of number of vehicles per square footage of the accessible building? So is there any limitation on the number of vehicles that can be parked or stored in an accessory building, namely a garage?
Not by zoning ordinance. I think it's the size would be self-regulating based on the type of vehicles that they would be storing within that building. I think this floor plan shows four. Mm-hmm. I think the applicant is here as well and could probably speak a bit better to the intended realistic use of the garage spaces.
Yeah.
And so the new garage, am I correct to assume it's roughly going to cover the footprint of the existing three-car garage that's there?
Yeah, it's actually there's a garage and an ancillary livable space.
Mm-hmm.
So the footprint of this new accessory building that
right
has replaced the demolished building is substantially in the same footprint of an existing
mm-hmm
building that's already there.
Meaning that the existing garage and that building next to the garage?
Yes.
That exists now?
Would be effectively replaced with this new garage.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yes.
Just wanted to get the visual.
There's no water table issues on that site?
We would not have that type of information at detail, but I would go back to the statement that I made about the building permit submittal, especially with any kind of excavation work, they'll need some kind of soils engineer on board.
Yeah.
Evaluate this.
That'd be cheaper than an elevator to get it back up. Okay. All right. Then any other questions of staff? Okay. I'll go ahead and open it up for the applicant.
Hello, my name is Tim Chappelle. I'm the architect working on the project. And it's funny because I've been doing this for 20 years in this town. I've never come to see you guys. I got two meetings tonight with you. So to explain really what's happening here is when we were going through, we met Stephanie, we were talking about the project. We were surprised, we knew we could do a basement level under the detached buildings, and we found out that there was something specific about automobile storage, and we understand that was for the subterranean driveways, et cetera, and all that grading. The intent of this is really to have two lifts. Usually, in the past, we've tried to lift the cars up into the attic space, but with detached accessory buildings in this town, there is a limit in height, and it becomes very cumbersome. So the owner really is looking at a flexibility of providing a lift, two lifts to go down, and it's for two automobiles, but it's also for kayaks and kids' toys and just stuff, storage. So the idea is it's not just to be an auto storage only, and there's not a huge car collection going on here, but it's just a matter of using this as storage space and providing as much flexibility as possible. The lifts are going to be awesome for just taking that couch that grandma has and get it down there and get out of the way too, instead of going through the house. So that's the intent of the design. And we located it, positioned it with the existing garage, did the arborist report, et cetera. And this is part of a bigger project of the main house, which will be going through the building department. And geotech report we've completed, all that will be part of the final project. Okay. But I'm here to answer any questions if you have anything.
I'm going to follow up on that. So this, from a safety standpoint, then theoretically the lift is another way out.
Yeah, it hasn't. I don't know. Did you do a cursory review of this? You said the building department.
I did take a quick look at the plans to determine that it is indeed non-habitable space.
Right.
The trigger that makes the planning commission review required.
Right.
We assume that it will probably have to be sprinklered. We anticipate that, so that was probably it's going to be assumed in part of the process, which will extinguish any internal fire. But we would vet that with the town and during the building department process if there was any issues. And we could do it immediately. It's not a problem.
Yeah, it might be. I don't know about the code requirement versus the safety aspect of it, but some kind of a ladder way out as opposed to the outside stairs, like through the
right.
floor.
Right, like an escape hatch or something on the opposite
door,
side.
Or
something.
Ladder up or something
not
like
dependent
that.
On electricity for the lift.
Right, right.
Like that.
Yeah. Just an emergency thing on the other side of the garage might be a good idea.
Spiral staircase and
on
the roof.
Yeah. Just an access stair like, or a ladder or anything like that. It's not a bad idea. I didn't think about that, but it's a valid
I just think the item, if you're on one side of the garage, having three older cars, I keep fire extinguishers near them and also their own smoke detector. So
the sprinkler system wouldn't be adequate for a car fire.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's a good idea. It's not a bad.
Yeah, so I would say just make sure that you're looking at that because of all the things, that and the water issue, because it's pretty low in that area.
Right, that's correct.
So, all right, anything else? That
I'm just trying to kind of wrap my head around exactly the visual on this. So we have three garage doors on the upper level, correct?
Yep.
Okay, the two interior doors would access the lift.
Correct.
Okay, the area up above to the left says vehicle showroom.
Right.
So how is that accessed and how is that going to be manipulated?
The idea was to be, in the event, it's kind of like a little display area. You see the doors opening up for like, it could be, the idea is that if the car is in, there's a car in there, they can use those sliding wheels that you rotate. You could just slide the car to the right. I mean, it could be a motorcycle. It could be something. It was just a flex zone. To have that flexibility, so that would be more of like a long-term kind of a potential showpiece on the upper level.
The area directly below that is a storage area,
right?
Subterranean.
That's correct. Just storage only.
When the cars are lowered, will there be any work done on the cars down there? Is that any kind of a mechanic?
It wasn't intended to be that way.
Okay.
The owner is not looking at. In fact, the owner doesn't like. Is not looking at doing older cars. It's more of a newer car, and it's not kind of like a situation where they're trying to do a mechanic shop or anything like that. It's mainly just.
So the part I'm having a tough time with visualizing.
Right.
So let's say you lower both cars. Okay. you're going to lose that square footage on the upper level, right?
No, the car. So the way it works, it's a kind of cool. Another client showed this to me in Saratoga, so where it all came from, is when you drive up, it looks like a normal garage when you pull in. It's completely level.
Right.
And if you want to get access to the lower car, you have to pull the car out of the driveway, and then the car, then the, what happens is the floor lifts up.
It's like an elevator. An elevator for that car.
Okay, so now you lower that car.
And then you could drive another car on top, but that's it.
Seems like there'd be a hole in the floor where the car
It's a box. It's like a cement box.
It's got a lid on it.
The lid's the floor.
All right, so that's what I'm not kind of getting at.
I should have done the 3D model.
So you're kind of driving the car into an enclosure, and then when it lowers, the roof of that enclosure
is the floor.
Is the floor
that's correct, yes.
Okay.
It's a cool thing. It's a unique thing.
It does say workshop over here at one end.
The tinkering, the bike shop. It's a bike shop for lots of bikes and stuff. Again, that's why you don't see another car in that bay. That's why we wanted to have an upper level to open the doors up, work on bikes, things like that, which is what everybody likes to do.
So, and then the other question I have regarding the stairwell,
mm-hmm.
and I was on the lot, I know it's well protected and there's separation from the neighbors and things like that, but this, essentially the stairwell, which could be like a light well, is closest to the neighbor's property.
Right.
Is there any consideration at all to putting that on the other side of the building?
Well, the stairwell doesn't have any windows on it, and the idea is it's going to be a seldomly used stair. So that is more of a service stair, and that's why it qualifies under the, non-conditioned space we're using down there. It's an idea is most of the time you just access the car. You know, you're lifting the car up. You're not actually going down in the basement unless for storage reasons or things like that. So it's like retrieval. So we see that use very, very light. That's why we are allowed by the town to have it on that side as opposed to on the internal side.
Okay, so this is where intent crosses over to how it could be used wrong,
mm-hmm.
and not by this owner. We definitely wouldn't want to turn it into a living space the way it's set up. And so I've seen these setups, and that you just got to remember not to lift it up when the other car's on top.
Yeah, I'm sure that's impossible.
It's an override,
yeah.
Because of safety. I just think since there are cars downstairs and people and there's motorcycles and things like that, ventilation is going to be really important, mm-hmm. and also an easy out. Mm-hmm. I mean, so somebody's going to get down there. I mean, there's gas in all the vehicles,
mm-hmm.
I've got a newer fancy car, and it sometimes takes more effort than the older not fancy cars, and so just the whole idea of making it really safety conscious with the idea of getting out of there quickly. Because sparks happen and somebody does something with the battery and things like that. So
we'll cover that when we review the plans that are actually submitted.
Yeah, so you're going to so this is it though, right?
No, we don't.
No.
We're giving her the ability to review this and to the staff level.
What we're asking tonight is for you to approve the use of this basement as a garage.
We're getting too granular.
Yeah, I know, but I'm doing it on purpose.
I'm just saying, but really all we're here to do is say, they'll go ahead and enforce whatever the building.
Mm-hmm. I know. There's just a lot of things that we'll trust you to do if we go ahead with this, because there's just some things on this thing that the intent now and what happens later are two different things,
mm-hmm.
and that's a little bit of an issue for me.
Well, I don't think you'd ever turn the engine over when it's in the lower position. There's no reason to do that. It's a retrieval. It's a storage. You know, it's not you're not supposed to work on the vehicles in there.
Yeah,
that's
we had a neighbor in San Carlos whose car, perfectly normal modern car, burst into flames in the night in their garage, burned up the car, burned the whole garage down, and would have burnt them down if they hadn't caught it in time. And those things happen.
Yeah.
So whether you start it up or not,
mm-hmm.
cars are flammable.
Yeah, go ahead.
So just going back to the intent of requiring basements, some basements to be considered by the planning commission, and some to just be able to be approved at the staff level. Those to be approved at the staff level, there was extensive discussion over that 2 years back. non-habitable space. I think the discussions that we had at that time were for storage. Effectively, that's going to be it. Equipment retention, pool equipment, generator, that kind of thing. Folks wanted to just jump in under there. So perhaps it's a question of does, even though by code, the use of a garage constitutes non-habitable space, it's defined again by the building code, does that adequately address the intent of the way that the ordinance was crafted?
Yeah, that's where I'm going on. Because non-habitable space means that it's a storage area that people don't go down to very often except to bring grandma's couch up.
Right.
You know, and when you have cars, you have people coming down there to see them.
Can we condition, I mean, it sounds like there's a concern that's getting further than what you're asked, what we're being asked to talk about tonight or decide on.
Mm-hmm.
Does it, I mean, is there, where's your client on this, or what flexibility do you have? And I'm not trying to open the door on this, but just trying to figure to get people comfortable with it.
Right, the owner is here.
Mm-hmm.
If you want him, if he wants
you,
him.
You're hearing all this. Do you have a concern?
Come on up and introduce yourself so you're on the record. So we're staying as legal as
good
we
evening.
Can. Okay, good evening.
My name is Andrew Wilson.
Yes, Andrew.
So do you have an issue with what you're hearing in terms of access or anything else? Because, I mean, otherwise this is just going to kind of keep rolling along.
So I think the idea of a ladder access on the other side is a good one. I think we can absolutely look at that. These are new cars. The idea is to put them down there and leave them there or bring them up. The idea really isn't to go up and down in and around them. It's not inhabitable space. There won't be a playroom. There won't be anything else done there other than put two cars down there, which I don't actually have right now, but I like cars, and there's a chance that I might have them in the future if I'm blessed to be able to get them. And so it's really just anticipating the future.
All right. Any other questions?
No.
All right. Thank you for bringing up. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you so much.
And if I can just add, I think sometimes it's hard because we told one set of things, but a whole bunch of hoops that happen after this.
Yeah.
And in my experience, the state of California goes above and beyond where there are safety things.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, many times they make you make it too far.
Right.
So rest assured, you know, this is really just addressing that first issue.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, you know, there are plan checks and the building code and inspections, and they will not allow something that is unsafe, and I think they do a pretty good job of being inclusive.
Okay, good. All right, anything else?
No, I'm okay with
all right.
So. Mm-hmm.
Good. All right, and I'm no other comments, no other questions. So I'm officially going to close the public hearing. So we're on record to close the public hearing, bring it back for the board to discuss and take action as appropriate. So with that, I'll bring it back. And I need a motion or not.
Happy to make a motion.
All right.
Move that the Planning Commission approve the special structure permit to allow basement garage under an accessory building at 168 Atlanta Avenue, subject to the conditions contained in the special structure permit certificate.
All right. Move.
And seconded.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? None? Aye. 5-0. All right. Thank you for the extra conversation.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. The red and black thing out there is mine. All right. All right, let's see. Mike's too old to be in that floor. All right, very good. And then 5C, special structures permit for 88 Reservoir Road. We'll turn it over to staff.
Thank you. So this is the first request before you since the new ordinance has been adopted that changed the special structures permit criteria to allow for consideration of requests to exceed the vertical sidewall height for main residences in the R1A zoning district from 22 feet up to 28 feet. If you recall, stepping back, the changes that were adopted still require an increased setback for every 1 foot of vertical height increase of sidewall. Specifically, for each 1 foot above that 22-foot maximum sidewall, the house must step back a minimum of 5 feet just to the areas of the building that are what we have referred to as the, quote, vertical offending area, i.e. taller than 22 feet. This application is a new home wanted taller internal ceiling heights, which was one of the purposes that had been expressed to the commission as to why are we even looking at this. And that was one of the requests of why the specific request, excuse me, is to increase their approved 22-foot sidewall height to 23 feet. you can see from the staff report, as well, maybe more visually explained in the site plan, that the areas of the second floor, which are requesting that 23-foot height, meet and in most cases actually well exceed that 5-foot setback increase beyond the standard front, rear, and side setbacks. Specifically, in the front, they go from 5 feet beyond the 60-foot setback up to 57 feet beyond the 60-foot setback. In the rear, that ratio looks to be 47 feet, and at the sides, it's a minimum of 5, but up to 73 feet. It's a pretty large property. The town arborist has visited the site, combined with the landscape screening that will be required, of course, towards the end of the building permit, as well as the extensive vegetation that currently exists. She finds that the area of that 1-foot height increase would be adequately screened from public right-of-way as well as adjacent properties. Speaking of adjacent properties, we did receive one public comment in writing from the property across the street on Reservoir Road stating their support of the application. I also met with the immediately adjacent property that 10 years ago went through the special structures permit to increase their own vertical height, and she had questions as to the setback increases and wasn't aware of the somewhat recent changes because she recalled the process where she had to step back her building at all four sides at both levels. And so I explained that process to her. We looked at the plans and she felt comfortable with the significant increased setbacks adequately helping to mitigate that increased vertical height. So for all of those reasons and as detailed in the staff report, we're recommending approval of the special structures permit as applications found to not impact any heritage trees and meets those setback criteria in the ordinance.
Any questions? Yeah, the only question I had going into this, there's so much stuff going on already. I'm going like, well, how is this coming before us now? So this is just basically increasing the height of something that was already planned, and it's got structurally set up to handle it and all the rest of it already.
Yeah, I believe the foundation's already
poured. Yeah, I know. That's why I've sitting there going, okay, the foundation's poured, so how do we get this late? So it wasn't late. It was just amended. Okay, all right, then I'm going to go ahead and open up the public. All right. Okay, guess who?
I'm Tim Chappelle from Arcanum once again. So this is a new ordinance, and so it's something that's, as we said, the house itself, I brought some of the 3D renderings I can pass around, is in essence kind of a wedding cake design already. It's a one-story massing up to a two-story. And it's always this thing with the town of Atherton is, you know, is the height of the building, and, you know, if there was a plane that came out that would, even though it had the same height, then that would be in line with the ordinances. So what we're looking at in this situation is we're trying to create these very simple boxes on top of each other. And part of the box is where the wall is. We prefer not to have an overhang in the massing of it. I'll send this around. So if you look at the renderings, there's a dashed red line I just drew while we're talking. And that dictates kind of what we're talking about, the different pieces around the second story element of the house, where we just have the wall extending to align with the top of the roof. And it's interesting, we're not trying to build these parapets. We have some tower elements which are going under less than the 400 square foot, but we're not trying to build towers up around the house and make it look massive. All we're trying to do is actually have the roof all in the same plane, the height of the walls, where the windows are, et cetera. So we're not trying to push it. And then as we talked about, as explained by Stephanie, is because the house, the way it's positioned on the site, in parts, in like one corner, it's one corner, and we're pushing the height limit, which is the one at, and the rest of it, we're really far deep into the house, in the property. So again, we're not trying to exploit this on all different levels. We're just trying to do the minimal, just so we can literally get a 10-foot ceiling, 9-foot, 9-foot ceiling, I think, in the lower level, and an 8-foot, 9 ceiling in the second level.
Okay.
which is a minimal request.
Okay.
I'm here to answer questions, provide any input.
Yeah, the topography of that area is going to be a natural shield.
Yeah.
So, no doubt about that.
And the colors of the house are dark and natural, which is interesting because the clients from out of the country, and they love this area specifically because it feels so rural, and that is what we're trying to do with the architecture, is really downplay the form.
Yep. All right, any questions? All right, thank you. Anyone else here to speak on this item? All right, then I'll go ahead and close the public hearing and bring it back for discussion and action appropriate with the commission.
Sure.
Yeah, it looks pretty straightforward to me, but it is a good example of the type of tweaks we're going to see for this new variation we have. And this was kind of the reason we did it.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
mm-hmm.
All right, looking for a motion? I'll take a second after the first.
Yeah.
Just the thing I do.
I move that the Planning Commission approve the special structures permit at 88 Reservoir Road based on the findings subject to the conditions listed in the draft special structures permit to allow the vertical side walls for the main residence at all four elevations to exceed the maximum allowable height of 22 feet, up to 23 feet 0 inches.
There's a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? You're aye.
I'm okay.
You're aye. Okay, good. Then 5-0 and no opposed. All right.
Thank you very much.
All right. Well, now we'll let's see you in about 20 years.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. Next item is item 5B, tentative map for 336 Walsh Road. And if you could flip it over to staff for an overview.
Consider a request for a tentative map to allow for the subdivision of the parcel at 336 Walsh Road into two new lots. Specifically, the commission is being asked to make a recommendation to the City Council, who will take final action on the tentative map at a future public hearing. So, brief overview, the site at 336 Walsh Road is 2.6 acres in area, contains an existing single-family home, detached building, and a substantial amount of trees, both heritage and non-heritage trees. The applicant is proposing to subdivide that property into two lots, demolish all of the existing buildings. The two lots referred to as parcel A, which if you're standing on Walsh Road is to the left, is a little over 1.1 acre in area, and parcel B, which I should note, I noted previously, it's erroneously referred to as a flag lot in the staff report. It is not a flag lot. Parcel to the right, if you're standing on Walsh Road, 1.455 acres in area. The site at 33 Walsh Road, the entire rear property line for the existing parcel and obviously the two new lots to be created, abuts a creek. You can see it's sort of jagged boundary line that follows the natural meandering of the creek. Both the area of both lots and the lot widths and depths exceed the the minimum subdivision standards of the town's municipal code. The creation of two lots also then by effect creates two new buildable areas as opposed to one big large buildable area. As it relates to trees, that actually increases the amount of trees to be protected by creating two buildable areas.
Mm-hmm.
You'll see on the plans there's some conceptual building site locations. I think that it's worthwhile to note, as one of the 10 required findings for tentative map approval is of the preservation of trees, that the project applicants and town staff, myself, and the town arborist worked extensively on the, again, conceptual locations of those buildings to minimize the amount of potential impact to heritage trees and results in the plans that you see today in a much higher preservation of actual amount of heritage trees versus what was or sewer and water will be able to be served to both lots. That has been confirmed as well. So coupled with the tree preservation efforts that I've described previously and all of the other details that are enumerated in the staff report, staff is recommending that the commission provide a favorable recommendation to the city council to adopt the tentative map as proposed. Happy to answer any questions of the project applicants slash property owners up here as well.
Okay. Any questions of staff?
I have a question. I may be missing something here. These pages aren't numbered, but on the third sheet, it says the continued use of the existing single-family residence will be permissible. And on the previous page, it says all existing structures will be demolished prior to recordation of final map. So I'm curious to know if the one is going to be preserved and the other one sold off as an empty lot, and if so, whether the one preserved, I presume somebody's looked into that, whether it meets the criteria for setbacks and so forth.
No, all existing structures on the building would be demolished.
On both lots.
Correct.
So it's for the state that here then says they're going to go.
Okay. Another rancher bites the dust. All right.
Okay.
All right. Any other questions? Okay, then I'll go ahead and open up for public comment from the applicants. Thank you for waiting.
Hi, I'm Lauren A. Cerusi. I'm an architect at Pacific Peninsula Architecture, representing the subdivision. And as staff already said, we think it's a pretty straightforward application. We were cognizant of the placement of the line between the two lots to, first of all, make the lots, you know, in keeping with the other lots in the neighborhood. So they're, you know, about the right size. Obviously, it's a conforming, at least an acre lot, but they're about the same size as other lots in the neighborhood. Also the location of the line, placing it so that we would avoid any major heritage trees or tree issues, works well for both us and the trees. So, and then another thing I wanted to point out is that we actually noticed neighbors about the subdivision and received no comments. So
okay.
I'm here to answer questions if there's anything.
Any questions? No, thank you. Thank you for waiting for all that.
No.
All right. All right, anyone else to speak on this topic? All right, then I'll go ahead and close the public comment and bring it back for discussion and action as appropriate by the commission. Anything on this?
It's good. I feel proud of being able to preserve the tree.
Yeah. It's a big lot. It's a really big lot. Mm-hmm. Wow, it's a big lot. All right, there's a little tiny technical thing that's been in the back of my head I should have asked you offline on. It has to do with what our affordable housing component gets changed by when you split a lot, because then you get because theoretically every time you add a lot you have to so at some point there's a 0.4 and then we'll see you trip to 0.5 and that makes you round up. So anyway, it's something for you to know. It's because it was you get the lot split, it changes your number. I was having fun with math trying to figure that out. So anyway, just for us planning geeks, that's something to think about.
We're considering.
We've done 2 lot mergers recently, so.
Oh, okay, good. All right. You done? It's like the people that drive a Prius for me, Austin Healy. We offset each other. All right, good. All right. I need a motion.
I'm happy.
All right.
Move that the Planning Commission recommend the City Council approve the tentative parcel map certificate allowing the subdivision of one lot into 2 lots at 336 Walsh Road based on the findings and criteria reasons incorporated in the staff report.
Second. Move and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 5-0. Just knocking down to that. All right. Thank you. All right. So, item 6, the Commissioner's Report. Anything to report? Has anybody been appointed to the commission? Any old commissioners been appointed?
I was reappointed.
You were reappointed?
You accepted? I think I did.
All right, so that means next time.
Here by accident.
Next time you might be sworn in, or next time or the run after that. Is it next time he's sworn in, I think. He has to be.
Did you do it again?
Yeah, I didn't know that either, but I had to be re-sworn in.
I just got notice yesterday.
All right, so probably next meeting you're going to have to be sworn in, you know. All right, good. All right.
Hey, Chief.
Thank you.
You're out of, you can go out of school now. You're good.
I wasn't going to say, but affordable housing in the outdoor economy makes sense to me.
Just tow that red thing out there.
All right. All right. Any other commissioners report?
What else do we have that's what's coming up? Like, are we on?
He's got, that's it, he's happy.
Oh,
yeah, this is the part where we tell her something.
Ah, okay.
And you're going to be okay.
I think so.
All right, good. I'm glad you're here. I'm really glad you're here. All right. That item number 7, staff report.
To your point, we do have a few items that have already submitted for the July Planning Commission meeting. Applications, special structures permit, and I think it's a heritage tree removal application. Also, staff's intending to bring back for the second round of study session, follow-up discussion on the potential revisions to the heritage tree ordinance as recommended by the ad hoc tree committee, as well as addressing the input that we've been receiving from the community. We did go out after our last meeting in April to the development community, and we're also going to be posting in the Athertonian and in the Almanac to gather more community feedback. So we may be presenting some alternative options too, based on the feedback that we've received, which has been pretty extensive.
Good. All right, and any other big planning stuff that we are that's coming up in the near future?
Not in the next
general
meeting. The general plan, yeah. Unfortunately, I'm trying to get myself back up to speed on that, but we're a little short-staffed. So the next step, I have the RFP created for some assistance in updating the traffic and circulation element of the general plan, so that the town can create some guiding criteria, which we don't have right now, particularly when other neighboring jurisdictions are doing large development and we have nothing to substantiate our comments by. So whether that's a level of service establishment, or sometimes they do now, it's now more industry standard of vehicle trips, so we'll work with that.
Will the town center stuff come to us at all or not? There's nothing out of ordinance,
so.
Right?
No,
we'll just go
just
straight through.
It's implementing the master plan, which you've
right.
The commission has already seen and taken action.
What about the rail in terms of trees? I noticed
the high-speed rail.
High-speed and the electrification of trees.
Mm-hmm.
All this. Will we get involved in that at all, or is that all typical right-of-way / eminent domain / whatever?
Well, I would presume. I'm not exactly sure. I'd probably need to follow up with a definitive answer to that question, but there needs to be some type of environmental component.
George was looking at George Roderick's at the city manager level,
yeah.
And working with them, I think they came through and said, we need to knock down everything, and we were
yeah.
Like, oh, hold up, you know,
right.
Could you be a little more specific? And I do think there was a certain amount of posturing back and forth
sure.
Between what we get to because we can.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And the town saying, okay, we'll go ahead and jump through those hoops then. So I think
mm-hmm.
It's sort of in a awkward stage. We'll see where it goes.
Okay.
That's my understanding.
Yeah,
there's been a lot of debate, like Palo Alto, the tree.
Right.
One thing.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm thinking, wow. Really?
Yeah.
So apparently, it's hopefully, I'm sure the outcry would go absolutely berserk, which I would be part of. That's going on. So I just
yeah.
Don't know if that's a planning
yeah.
commission model or just
yeah.
flies over our heads to
yeah.
council. Which
yeah, really,
either way is fine, but I just was curious.
I'll follow up with the city manager's office and report back in the next week.
All right, that's good. That's good. Yeah. Anything else?
Nice to have Paul back.
Yeah. Nice feedback.
Yeah.
Okay.
Believe me.
All right. That's it. No more from Zach. Okay. That item number 8 just keeps on popping up every time. You need a motion?
I'll move that we adjourn.
Moved in second. Is it second?
Second.
All right, moved in second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.